Have you ever read an awesome science fact, only to do a little bit of digging and learn the source blew things way out of proportion? I'm gonna let you behind the SciShow scenes for a bit. Our script editors are always on the hunt for weird and complex science stuff. And last year, one of them was reading a book about beavers, and 150 odd pages in, the author suddenly mentioned there's a type of octopus off the coast of Australia that, quote, builds the equivalent of a walled medieval city, which, if true, would probably make for a good SciShow episode. As you may suspect, that quote turned out to be a gross mischaracterization of reality, and this book is not the only source to have gotten a little bit, let's say, overenthusiastic about what scientists actually uncovered. But our script editor was undeterred by this setback, and with a little more research, it was clear that these structures are still super weird and reveal just how complex the octopus lifestyle can be. So let's break down what's really going on in these octopus cities. As much as we'd love to animate an octopus gripping medieval tools with their many tentacles and shouting, "Forsooth," and "The devil take thee," the real animals behind these not actually cities look like this. This is Octopus tetricus, also known as the gloomy octopus, because its large, sad eyes give it sort of a emo vibe. Until recently, scientists thought it was a solitary creature, preferring to hang out in its bedroom alone, listening to My Chemical Romance and Nessa Barrett until 3 in the morning. But then, they started discovering sites where gloomy octopuses gather. And for context, all of this is taking place in Jervis Bay, which is about a 2-hour drive south of Sydney, Australia. The first site was discovered back in 2009, and researchers nicknamed it Octopolis. It's centered around a 30-centimeter long unidentified sunken object, something that definitely humans made, but that's pretty much all we can say about it. And that's okay, because the real star of the show is the hoard of scallop shells and other debris that the octopuses have collected around it and used to construct their dens. And then in 2016, divers found Octlantis, a second site just a few hundred meters away from Octopolis. And here, these gloomy octopuses have surrounded 3 patches of rock with similar piles of debris, including human things like beer bottles and lead fishing lures. And the fact that Octlantis wasn't seeded by a human-made structure is actually pretty important from the science side of things, because it shows that Octopolis wasn't an unnatural fluke that only happened because of some accidental outside human influence. At both of these sites, researchers have observed groups of 2 to 15 octopuses engaging in behaviors like mating and poking each other with their tentacles and kicking other octopuses out of their homes. And a paper from 2022 also reported that these gloomy octopuses throw things. And sometimes it kind of looked like it was on purpose. Throw isn't exactly the right word, though. It's kind of more like directed squirting, but still not a very nice neighborly thing to do. Ultimately, there's not much about these two sites that screams city, but the names Octopolis and Octlantis sure sound like large metropolitan areas populated by sentient cephalopods that you'd find in a sci-fi novel. The experts who came up with these nicknames didn't use them in their research papers, but they're eye-catching, and the SciShow team is well aware of how important it is to make a title eye-catching. Some of the media coverage about Octopolis and Octlantis only featured the word city in the title, and then switched to a less suggestive term like structure for the rest of the article. But let's all be honest with ourselves, how often do we only read the headline and then keep on scrolling? There may have also been some confusion generated by a term the researchers used in their work, ecological engineering. So to a non-specialist, it might sound like large construction projects, and if we're sticking to the non-human sort, maybe something like a beaver dam. But it actually has a much broader definition that includes any type of environmental modification by a living thing. The press release announcing the discovery of Octlantis quoted a researcher who referred to the octopuses as true environmental engineers, and a few sources seem to have extrapolated from this jargon and claimed the octopuses also built fences and created art. And of course, there were those medieval walled cities that got our script editors' hopes up. But before we get into what is inarguably the coolest science story of all time, we've got to keep the lights on. So here's an ad.
This SciShow video is supported by Brilliant, the personalized online learning platform. Brilliant is crafted by an award-winning team of teachers, researchers, and professionals from MIT, Harvard, Stanford, Caltech, Google, and more. It's real humans teaching you cutting-edge concepts in AI and quantum. Those experts are usually teaching giant rooms of students all at once, but Brilliant has packaged their knowledge into personalized learning opportunities for you. Brilliant starts you at the right level based on your background, designs practice sets and reviews for you and helps you advance at your ideal pace. To learn for free on Brilliant, go to brilliant.org/scishow, scan the QR code on screen, or click on the link in the description. They're also giving you unlimited daily access to everything on Brilliant with 20% off an annual premium subscription.
So, putting the media frenzy aside, here's what scientists have really said about Octopolis and Octlantis. The two sites do reveal the gloomy octopus is way more social than scientists once believed, and they add to a growing body of evidence that octopuses, in general, are more social than we thought. That's a valuable discovery in its own right. And now that we know these sites exist, they'll help researchers study octopus behavior and fill the gaps in our knowledge base about these weird and wonderful creatures. Which leads me to one major outstanding question. Did the residents of Octopolis and Octlantis make a conscious decision to build their communities? Scallops are part of the gloomy octopus's diet, and waiting to snack until you're back inside your den is safer than out in the middle of nowhere. So it makes sense that discarded shells would be found around a gloomy octopus's home in large numbers. The residents of Octopolis and Octlantis seem to be deliberately choosing to build their dens in piles of scallop shells, but the sites themselves might have begun as happy accidents. The experts behind the Octopolis discovery hypothesized that the first octopus probably built a den in the area because some shells were already present and made for a better building material than sediment. This may have created a positive feedback process where the octopus brought back ever more prey to its den and unintentionally provided more building material as it haphazardly just tossed out the trash. Another octopus may have eventually moved into the area to take advantage of that trash, started doing its own local snacking, and so on and so forth. And suddenly, you're left with a bunch of octopus neighbors adapting to deal with each other's presence. Now, this hypothesis doesn't mean there's no intention behind what these octopuses are doing. Some have been observed using inedible objects, like sponges, to create a hatch at the opening of their dens. They've also been observed cleaning their dens, using jets of water to get rid of unwanted stuff, like broken shells, algae, and silt. But if you want an octopus city, you're gonna need more than a bunch of individual octopuses intentionally making and managing their own homes in the same general area. Sure, it might be a little bit too much to ask for an octopus shopping mall or art museum, but scientists haven't observed any evidence of cooperative construction or a sense of sustained community. So the main takeaway from Octopolis and Octlantis isn't, oh my gosh, the octopuses are building cities. It's more like, oh my gosh, the octopuses aren't automatically a bunch of asocial loners after all, and they are building cool stuff. These sites show that normally solitary octopuses are highly adaptive socially, and they're willing to congregate if the environment supports it. But there are still plenty of unanswered questions. Scientists still aren't sure what the costs and benefits are of living a solitary life versus a communal life. For example, aggressive behavior in these communal locations has costs. It uses energy, and it may increase the risk of becoming food for a predator. So scientists will have to do more research before they understand why the residents of Octopolis and Octlantis are choosing to stick around for however long they do. But in the meantime, we're excited to see how Octopolis and Octlantis continue to thrive. And if there's any updates, we'll be sure to let you know. Because after all, there might be a third or a fourth octopus city somewhere out there.